Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallis, and in this video we're going to look at setting up Kerberos. So we're going to set up a Kerberos server, and on this one server we're going to set up the Kerberos client so we can use SSH. In a later video we'll look at setting up a second client, but in this video we're going to be both the Kerberos server, the KDC, and the Kerberos client. We will need time set up, so we would need our system synchronizing through to a time server. In my case, it's virtualized and it will be picking up time from the host. And when I add in the second client, it will be picking up time from the host as well. So from that point of view, we can see then that I don't need to worry too much about time. But in your own environment, for Kerberos authentication, we do need to make sure that the servers and the clients have the same time. We, of course, also need to be able to resolve the names. So I'll be using this machine as a Kerberos server, so server 1, and I'm saying that it's server1.tup.com. So if I go through and ping s1.tup.com and try and get a dot in there instead of a forward slash, you'd think I'd know these things, wouldn't you? We can see we're getting a response back. I'm doing this through localhost rather than DNS through my localhost file, but I can also get to the machine S2. And in the same way, S2, when we use that as a Kerberos client in a later video, that of course will need these same entries. But in your own environment, if it's just a play or test environment, certainly use your own host. But in a more substantial environment, of course, we'd be using DNS. So to say, this machine is going to be our Kerberos server, our KDC and the Kerberos administration server, as well as being the Kerberos client. So we're going to install the required utilities. So KRB5-server, which is obviously putting on the server requirements. KRB5-workstation, which of course then is putting on the client requirements. We want authentication, so again part of our client will be then the PAM and KRB5 package. And of course, I don't know what's happening today, but we need an install going on here. That's a lot better. So we can see that going through, so let's go through and allow that. We're going to have to edit and tidy up some files. So in the first instance, I'm going to move through to the var Kerberos and then KRB5 KDC directory. Within this directory, when I run the listing, you see I've got a couple of files. So I've got the kdc.conf and the kadmin.acl. First of all, when we go into the ACL file, here it's saying */admin. Anybody who's given the admin role is then going to be an administrator. But we can see that it's for example.com and we're working with tup.com. So we go through and replace this. The realms are in uppercase as opposed to your normal DNS names. So we've made then the change to the kadm5.acl. When we look at the kdc.conf, so let's go through and edit the kdc.conf. We can see that we're configuring the ports that we're going to listen on. I'm not using a firewall, but in your own environment, we'd need to make sure that those ports were opened up. And we then need to go through and again change our realm from example through to tup. Obviously put in the domain name or realm that you're working with. Once we go through then and save that configuration file, that's as much as we need to do for this directory. It's really the configuration of the server in here. And again, when we look at the working directory, this is in var, and very often the var structure, remember, is for your variable data. So we're going to start creating more files in here as we initialize the Kerberos database and start running the servers. Let's move through to the etc directory for the moment. And here we're going to look at the client configuration file, so krb5.conf. So the /krb5.conf. Again, as we run through, we can see where we're writing the log files. As we go down, we've got then the default realm that we can uncomment out. And we can say, well, if we don't specify the realm, then let's go through and use up. Then we've got to set up the properties of the realm. So again, looking at replacing example here. So of course, as we mentioned before, you make sure that you use the realms that you are working with. So again, uncomment the information and point through to your realms and servers. We can see here that we're pointing through to a server, so the KDC that we're working with, the Kerberos Distribution Center. So this is where the tokens are going to be issued from. So I'm going to put in here s1.tup.com and then the administration server. So the administration server manages the database. So again, we're going to put in here s1.tup.com. You can see a very cheap and easy way of saving a lot of work is to call your server kerberos.example.com and work in the realm example.com. So as in a simple play environment, that would be the easiest thing to do. But the reality is we need to get some experience and hands-on making the changes that are necessary for your real work environment. Here we're then running the mappings. So we're mapping .example.com through to the tup.com. So domain name to realm mapping. So the domain and anything in the domain is going to come through as the realm tup. Of course, you can go through and do some search and replace, so some substitutions in here to make just life just a little bit easier. But of course, we're trying to talk through the changes that need to happen, so it's easier to run through and make the change. So this then is the configuration file, the krb5.conf, that we're going to find in the etc directory. Now, if I go back, so I'm going to use cd minus, this is going to take us back into, let's just do this, then pwd. So it's taking us back into the var, Kerberos, and krb5 KDC. We run a listing here. We can see we just have the configuration files that we created before. We're going to run now the command to create and initialize our database. So we can then go through, use kdb5 _util and then create and then minus s and then the realm we want to put as tup.com. Now at this stage you need your random number generator running, otherwise you're going to get the messages coming back that we can't create enough entropy. So if you haven't got that up and running, then take a look at my previous videos where we look on CentOS 7 of setting up the random number generator. But we can then go through and enter the KDC master key. So the passphrase or password to protect the keys. So it won't exist at the moment. We'll be creating it. If I go through and run the listing here, we can see now that we've got the databases that have been created. So now using systemctl, we're going to start the KDC, so KRB5 KDC. And the kadmin service. And if we go back and then enable the services, so we start them so they're running and then we enable them for system start. And that's then have our systems up and running. We're now going to start adding some entries into the Kerberos database. Kerberos is going to allow us to authenticate. The idea being is that we can authenticate once and then start passing our tokens around. So we use nkadmin, and we're then just going to the local admin server. If I go through and use something like list principles, I can use tab completion here to see what's available. But we can see then that we've got basic entries in here. We're going to start putting in some additional entries. So the first thing we do is add a principal. And we're going to assign root through to the admin role. Remember, we're saying that anybody who's got the admin role can manage the system. And let's just get print with an N. But it was a good demonstration just to show you that if you get an error, you're going to be shown what to type. But now we're going to be setting up a password for the root user. This is a password in the KDC database, so it can be a separate password and probably should be a separate password to the normal root password. Again, going through now and using the list principles, we can see that we've added root and admin in. If I want my ordinary user account, the Tux account, to be able to log in, he's already an account in Linux, but we then need to create an account for him in the Kerberos database. So again, we use then the same command and then Tux. So I've already created this account within Linux. This is my normal user account. We're now adding this account into the Kerberos database. And the same thing, we're going to go through and apply a Kerberos password for this user account. Now the idea is that we can then log in, pick up our Kerberos token, and present the Kerberos token to servers that trust this KDC. So we're going to add then a principal for this server. So we can go set up a random key for authentication for the server, and then host and s1.tup.com. Obviously, when I set up my second server, we'll be adding in a server for this. Again, we can go back and list our principles. So we can see the entry then for the host entry for server one, as well as the administration entry, which was there by default. So it's saying that this host itself can act as a server that hosts Kerberized services, and users can use Kerberos to authenticate through to this server. We'll see all of this working. We then need a copy of the Kerberos database to be copied across into the etc directory of this server. So we go through and run kt add, so key tab add, through to the host, and then s1.tup.com. So it has it within its database directory, but it also needs a copy of this within the etc directory. And then we can run the quit command. And we want to be able to use SSH, so we need to make sure that SSH is Kerberos. So we're going to look at configuring the Kerberos authentication through our client. So we can /etc/ssh /, and then ssh_config. And then we go down to look for GSS. And we can see that we've got these lines that are commented out. I'm going to uncomment them. So the GSS API authentication, so this is our Kerberos authentication. So we want to then go through and say yes, and then yes underneath here. So the delegate credentials, so two settings that we need to make in our SSH_config. We can then go through and save those changes. To allow for authentication, we run our auth config and -- enable Kerberos authentication, so KRB5. And all of this that we're working from is looking at setting up the client. We want to allow this SSH server to be able to accept Kerberos authentication, so KRB5. And then -- update. Just make sure that the SSH server knows about the changes so we can go through and run the reload. So we're just about there, but if we go back, clear out of this screen, and just look at some of the history, we can see from line 42, we are setting up our Kerberos server. We're also installing the workstation elements. On line 44, we're then going through into the var Kerberos structure. When we look at the listing, we can see then the configuration files. We change all of the references from example to tup, so setting up the realm names in those configuration files. We then go through into the etc directory and we tidy up the client configuration, the kerberos5.com. So we have the Kerberos server, which looks after the Kerberos database. And then we have Kerberos clients. The Kerberos clients are really the servers that host services. Having done that, we then go through and create the Kerberos database for the realmtup.com. We can see that on line 54. We start and enable the services. So all of this is our service configuration. As we continue down, we can see then we go into kadmin. And again, this is still going to be working on our server, but it's going through creating the principles. So this is then adding in users to our Kerberos database and servers to our Kerberos database. When we look on line 59, this is more now setting up our clients, enabling our clients to be able to use Kerberos authentication. And for our client systems, setting up PAM authentication using Kerberos. So why is this important? We're going to start seeing this now. If I go in as my ordinary account So I'm going to switch through to the tax account. Remember, we added a principal to this. If we look at some of the client tools, if I go through and look at KList, this is looking at any of the Kerberos tokens that I have, and at the moment I don't have any. We use then KInit to connect to the Kerberos server and get a token. When I do so, it's going to prompt me then for the password. This is the Kerberos password. So I can then go through and put in my Kerberos password. Now when I use the KList command, we can see that I've got my Kerberos token. By default, we keep the token for 24 hours. We could set the timeout to be a smaller time, but this is all that's set on the Kerberos server. Now what that means then with SSH or any Kerberized server is once I've authenticated to the Kerberos server, I pass my token through to those resources that use Kerberos authentication. So if I go SSH server1.tup.com, this is the first time that I've connected, so I've got to accept the public key of the server. But we can see then that I'm connecting without being prompted for the password. And of course, and if I exit out of this, we're jumping out of the SSH connection. But because I've got the public key now, then if I go back and SSH in, I'm going to jump straight in. Now you can imagine if you're managing a lot of servers, being able to jump onto one server, then using your KInit to get your Kerberos token, and then you're able to connect without having to manage public keys and private key pairs for the user to any other server. And we can also use these Kerberos tokens to access other resources such as Samba. So hopefully you understand a little bit more now about setting up a Kerberos server. So we set up the Kerberos and the Kerberos client on this machine. In a later video, we'll set up server 2, and that can be set up just as a Kerberos workstation. And then hopefully you'll get a better idea of how then, without configuring very much on the system, we'll be able to use the account that we've got here, Tux, and the password and the tokens that we've already created to be able to authenticate on the SSH server on the S2 machine. But thank you very much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you back on the Urban Penguin channel very soon.